So you have a test Tuesday, right? Next Tuesday. And I don't know why the deadline for the practice test was today, but of course it's too short, so I have extended to 1 week. So you have one more week to do the practice test. It doesn't count for your grade, but I try to make it like very similar to the real test. And if you do really well, I'll give you extra credit like last time. But it doesn't count. Okay, it's just a practice test. And then I think you have assignment. I don't know for tomorrow or Thursday. If you need extension, just let me know. And we stopped here. And everything below that, it's not in the test. It's going to be on test 3. So test 3 is online. Okay, I will give you a window like from 9 to 12 or something like this. And it's going to be online. It's very not comfortable. No, it will be at night. So what did we learn? We remember that an electric field can accelerate a charge. It does not matter if it's a negative charge or a positive charge. An electric field always is tugging on the charge, so it can accelerate. So an electric field can change the kinetic energy of a charge. The electric force is QE. So it works like gravity, right? So the same way gravity wants to lower the level of energy of mass to bring it down to a lower potential energy, so does the electric field. So if you have a positive charge, the electric field, yeah. If you have a positive charge, the electric field tries to bring down the potential to a lower level of energy. And then we looked at the magnetic force. So this is called actually Lorentz force. And I think I have a video. Very short video. So it's called Lorentz force, right? And remember, if there is a current flowing and you have this current inside the magnetic field, so for example, if the magnetic field is inside the blackboard, so that means inside the blackboard. Okay, so inside the blackboard. So last time someone complained, if you can see here, but if the current is going this way, the magnetic field is inside the blackboard, so the force is going to be up. Right? Someone said, very beautiful flower. So if the current is going this way, so that will be positive charge, magnetic field is inside the blackboard, the force is up. Now, if you have an electron, instead of having a positive charge moving, the force will be just the opposite. So you can still use your right hand, but the force will be down instead of up. Okay? And what did we find? We had an equation here that says that the magnetic force equals the current times the length of the wire inside the magnetic field. So for example, I don't know, maybe I have a battery here, and so the current is flowing and I just have that piece of wire inside your magnetic field, so that will be the length. So the magnetic force will be I, the current going through the wire, L, the size of the wire, times the magnetic field, times the angle between, so that will be the angle between I and B. So if I ask you, you know, conceptual question, if the magnetic field is parallel to the current, there is no force. You need to have a component perpendicular to the magnetic field, okay? So if the current is along the magnetic field, there is no force. And this is called the magnetic force on the wire. And next, we're going to see, but I think we already have seen that, that if you have a moving charge with a speed V inside a magnetic field, it is also going to be acted by a force. And the equation is QVB times the sine between B and V. Okay, so we did that already, but it's still the right-hand rule. Now, what you have to remember for the test, I think it's for the test or for the assignment, the magnetic field cannot change the speed of a charged particle. It cannot make it go faster or slower. The only thing it can do is to curve it, right? To apply a centripetal force, to make it take a turn. But it cannot change its speed and it cannot change its kinetic energy, which is different from the electric field. An electric field can speed up a charge or slow down a charge, right? So electric field works like gravity, and this works like a centripetal force. Okay, so I don't know if you remember, but I show you some simulation. Oh, here I have a short movie.
A magnetic field. Applies no force at all.
No.
A magnetic field.
Very mysterious to me how that
applies no force at all to an electric charge at rest.
Oh, that's the other point. If the charge is not moving, you cannot have a magnetic force. To have a magnetic force that will curve the charge, you need the charge to move and to have some angle with the magnetic field, okay? Otherwise, there is no force.
However, if the electric charge is in motion, There's a magnetic force.
So if you try to do this, so speed is going this way, velocity is going this way, the magnetic field is up, the force is towards you. You see that the force here is perpendicular to the velocity. Because the force is perpendicular, it cannot tug on the charge, it cannot make it go slower or faster. The only thing it can do is change the direction. So that means the charge wants to go in this direction. No, you can't. No, you have to move here. Okay, so I want to go in a straight line at a constant. No, you can't. You have to come here, right? So there will be, if you let go, there will be like a circular motion. Yes, this is called the centripetal force.
Called the Lorentz force. It's perpendicular to both the field and to the direction of motion of the charge. The force is conveniently expressed using the vector cross product.
There you go. You see how it works? Now I'm not holding the charge anymore. I let it go. It has an initial velocity to begin with. So there is nothing to slow it down, so it's going to keep the same velocity inside the magnetic field. The velocity is coming toward you, B is up, so the force is perpendicular. The force is perpendicular to both the velocity and the magnetic field. And each time you have a force perpendicular to a velocity, that force cannot change the velocity. The only thing it can do is to make the mass, the charge, going into a circle. Okay, it's a centripetal force. So it's like you are holding a horse and the horse wants to gallop, you know, to get away from you, but you are holding it this way. So you're making the horse, you know, going into a circle, but you are not making the horse going faster or slower. So it's a centripetal force.
The electric charge is always perpendicular to the velocity. The force doesn't speed it up or slow it down. Instead, charges tend to curve around the field in circular or helical paths. In non-uniform magnetic fields, electric charges can be trapped, as they are, for example, in the Van Allen radiation belts.
So do you remember, I don't know if there is a conceptual question about that because I forget, but you remember the Earth is like a bar magnet. The South, it has the geographic North, and the North is at the geographic South, such as if you have a compass, compass has a North seeking side and it will point to the geographic North because actually it's a magnetic South. Do you remember that? And the magnetic field always likes to circulate, it never ends. You know, it likes to go from the north into the south, through the bar magnet, you know. So it goes around and around and around. And if there is a charge coming from space, which can be very damaging, you know, we have always radiation coming from space, and lucky for us, our immune system is such a fantastic machine that it learned how to fix itself. When the immune system cannot fix itself, it will commit suicide, like the DNA will commit suicide. So we have evolved in such an environment, so the immune system knows how to fix itself. But nevertheless, we still have a magnetic field to protect us against those cosmic rays, because they're going to be trapped inside the magnetic field. So the charge wants to circulate around the magnetic field lines, okay? So it will go around, but at the same time, it has a speed forward. So it's moving two things at the same time. It's going around the magnetic field, like I just showed you before, but at the same time, it's moving forward, so it's going to do something like in spiral, and then it's going to reverse and go back, and it's trapped, so it's good for us, so we are not bombarded by cosmic rays all the time, right? That might be not a good idea.
Near the polar regions, charged particles sometimes get close enough to strike the atmosphere, giving off light like electrons striking a television screen. That's the origin of the spectacular aurora at the North and South Poles. In general, however, the effect of the magnetic field is to keep charged particles away from the Earth.
Okay, I think I have another demonstration here. And in that case, it's going to be an electron that be trapped inside the magnetic field, and you can see the circular motion. It's called a cyclotron.
Welcome to the demo prep room. We're sitting here in the dark because we're going to show you that a charged particle beam does indeed go in a circle when you put it in a uniform magnetic field. So this is an evacuated glass bowl, and there's an electron gun in it. An electron gun really just means a heated metal filament that's easy to...
So he has like an electron gun. An electron gun is just like a very hot filament that will burp out electrons. Those electrons, you know, are going to circulate around the uniform magnetic field. So it's going to go in a circle.
Draw electrons off of. Near the gun, you can now see glowing orange, is a little metal plate. We put in a large positive potential. So that sucks the electrons up to a few hundred volts at the plate. The plate has a hole in it so that some of the electrons keep going in the form of beam.
So this is the beam of electron?
It hits the glass.
So here there is no magnetic field.
A little bit of gas that's inside the bowl. So you're seeing light from the gas, but it's there because the beam is shooting through the gas. So you're seeing the electron beam indirectly. Now we know that we bring a magnet nearby, it'll reflect the beam. So here's my north-south R magnet, and sure enough, one pole pushes it up, another pole shoots it down. If I bring it in and do these kinds of things, you can do all kinds of crazy patterns with the beam. If you bring in a...
We used to do that with the old TV. And then you will ruin the screen. We have the very old TV. I don't know if you know them. Like they look like a big box. And then you bring a magnet and then you play with it. Because inside you have electrons beam, you know, hitting the screen and sweeping out images.
Strong concentrated magnetic field. But what we're here to do is to create a uniform field. That's what these two big coils are. So this is a large coil of wire on one side of the bulb, large coil on the other side.
So the electron, so together, let's say it goes this way,
magnetic field on the inside.
Magnetic field goes in, so the force is going to be this way.
We'll see what pattern the electron beam takes. So here we're going to start turning it up.
So he's turning on the magnetic field, and you see how you can curve the electron beam.
But the radius is too big, it doesn't fit in the bulb. So if I keep turning it up, more and more current, bigger and bigger B field.
So he's increasing the magnetic field, and now you can force the electrons to go into a circle. And that's going to be a very big deal, because you have something called atom smasher. Okay, so what you do, you take protons, for example, and you speed them up, go around, speed them up, go around, speed them up, go around, and at the end, you're going to crush them together, and you're going to discover new stuff being made, right? Because E equals MC squared.
Perfect circle.
So that's the idea.
Going right back to where it started. And if I turn the magnetic field back down.
Isn't that cool? Okay, let's go back to the math. So here we have a magnetic field, and here we have a proton moving. Do you think there will be a force acting on that proton?
No.
Oh, very good. Why? They are parallel to each other. You need at least one component that is perpendicular. So there will be no force. And in that case, yes, the proton is going this way. You know, toward me, the magnetic field is going this way, the force is going up, okay? So the proton wants to do a circular motion, it wants to go around. So in that case, there will be a force. In that case, too, there will be a force. The angle between the velocity here and B, the velocity is here, B is here, the angle is sine. Okay, so let's answer those questions. So we're going to take this case here. So you have V, B, F, and you have an angle theta between the velocity, so that will be your velocity, and B. And they want to find the force, just plugging in, right? So you have here again, that's your B, that's your V, so V, B, F, F is up, and that will be the angle between B and V. So the Lorentz force is, the magnetic force is Q, V, B, and then you have a sine and of the angle between B and V. I'm going to do that this way. So that will be your equation. So for a magnetic force to happen, you need a charge. It doesn't work on neutron. Neutron will not experience a force. You need a charge to move. You need a magnetic field, and they cannot be parallel to each other. B and V cannot be parallel to each other. Because if the angle between V and B is zero, so the force, the magnetic force, is zero. Okay, let's see what they have here. You have the proton, you have the speed. So it's a very fast proton, 5 times 10 to the 6 meter per second. Q, the charge of a proton is the same as the charge of an electron. And what else is given? B is 0.4 Tesla, and the angle is 30 degrees. Okay, so you just plug it in. So F magnetic equals Q, so 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19, V 5 times 10 to the 6, B 0.4, and then you have sine 30. So magnetic force is very picky. Not only you need to have a charge, it doesn't work on the neutron, the charge has to be moving, otherwise nothing happens, and then you need to have an angle between V and B, otherwise there is no force. And then that force, the only thing it can do is to steer, to curve, to turn, not to speed up. So what do you get? I have no idea what's that. Okay, so 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19, close the parenthesis, open the parenthesis, the speed 5 times 10 to the 6. Okay, we good. The magnetic field is 0.4. Okay, cool. And then sine 30. Okay. And we get that. Did you get that? Yes? Okay. So that's going to be 1.6 times 10 to the negative 13 Newton. And that force here, it's going to make the proton go around the magnetic field. So the magnetic field is in this direction. The protons wants to go around. Is that clear? See, because there is a force here. So it wants to go around like this. Now, if it was already moving in this direction, it's going to do something like this. If it was not moving in that direction, if you didn't have a component in this direction, so just making a circle. Okay, what else do they want? The acceleration. So if you could look up the mass of a proton, I think it's like 10 to the negative 27, and I lost my mass of a proton. I think it's 6.67 times 10 to the negative 27 kilogram. Is that right? If you have your equation sheet. 1.67 times 10 to the negative 27. Ah, so see, I'm always almost there. So that's a 1, thank you. That's a 1. 1.67 times 10 to the negative 27. Okay, and then we have Newton's second law, F equals ma. And in that case, remember, this acceleration is just the change in direction. It's not an acceleration like speeding up or slowing down. This is called the centripetal acceleration. It means you are changing your motion, but you are changing your direction and not your speed. Okay, you are not going, it's not going slower or faster, it's just going into a circle. So the acceleration will be 1.6 times 10 to the negative 13 divided by the mass. So 1.67 times 10 to the negative 27. You have to be very careful to frame everything here. So divide, open the parenthesis, 1.67 times 10 to the negative 27. You get that? Did you get that?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's going to be acceleration. It's a centripetal acceleration, 9.6, 10 to the 13 meter per second per second. But it's not moving faster. Okay, it's just, who wants to go in a straight line at a constant speed? No, you can't. You know, it's like you are falling here. I want to keep going in a straight line at a constant speed. No, you can't. You know, falling here. So you are forced to go into a circular motion. So this is called a centripetal acceleration. Okay? So again, for magnetic force to happen, you need a charge. the charge has to be moving, and there must be an angle between B and V. If they are parallel to each other, there won't be any force. Question C, what's going to happen if you have an electron instead? So then it will go in the opposite direction. It will go a circle, but in the opposite direction, right? So I think I have a simulation over there. So here, I have an electron gun, say. So you're going to have a beam of electrons, or it could be a beam of protons. I can change the speed, so let's make it go really fast. And let's say it's positive. Positive charge, so which way it's going to curve? So moving this way. Magnetic field when it crosses, it goes in. Left. Right? Very beautiful flower. I like that. Boom. You see that? Now, if instead of having positive charges, I have negative charges, it's going to curve in the other opposite direction. Does it make sense? So that's going to be very important if you go into the medical field, for example, biomedical or chemistry, because that's how we're going to separate molecules or isotopes, right? So if you have a bunch of molecules, you know, and they are all together and you cannot split them apart, you have them going through a magnetic field. And the very big one, the heavier one, will have a big curve. So it's going to end up here. And the small one, we have a short curve. So the big one has more inertia, so it will be harder for the magnetic field to curve. So let's say you have isotopes. No, when you have isotopes, you cannot separate them using chemistry because they have all the same chemical properties. But they have different mass. So if you have isotope here coming in, the big one will make a big curve, and the small one will make a small curve. So then you can move your detector here and collect the one that you want. It's called spectromass, right? Mass spectrometer. Thank you. Or spectromass. I don't know if you can say spectromass. Maybe mass spectrometer is better. Okay, so we can use that to identify particles, for example, coming from space. Let's say, and I would like to get to radioactivity in case some of you may be going to go into nuclear medicine, for example, or radiotherapy. So if you have a gamma particle, gamma does not have any charge. Do you think it's going to be deflected by a magnetic field? No charge, no deflection, right? It will zoom straight, and it will not be deflected. Gamma ray is just light with very high energy. Gamma rays, that's what you're going to use to make a PET scan, for example. So it has a very, very high energy, high frequency, but no charge because it's part of light. Alpha particle, do you know what alpha particles are? Hydrogen. What's next after hydrogen? Not just after hydrogen. Helium. So it's two protons and two neutrons. Alpha is just the nucleus of helium. So it has two protons, right? So twice the charge of a proton. So it's positively charged. So magnetic field is, okay, magnetic field is from north to south. Alpha going this way, force going up. Right? If you do the three fingers, magnetic field goes from north to south. North to south. Alpha going this way. It's good stretching. So the force is up, so it's going to be deflected up. And here you have a beta particle. Do you know what a beta particle is? It's just an electron. And so the electron will be curved down. So in the 1930s, they built what it's called a cloud chamber. And in the cloud chamber, it's a chamber that has a cloud, for example, of alcohol, but in vapor, right? So it's alcohol, but like a vapor. No, you don't drink it. I'm going to show you. I have a movie of that. So it's just like a big aquarium, if you want. And inside you have vapor of alcohol, and each time there's a particle coming in, you can see it. You can see the trace of the particle. Now, if you apply a magnetic field, you see that some particles, they're going to curl in one direction. Some particles are going to curl in the other direction. Some particles will not curl at all, so we can identify the particles. Okay, that was a Nobel Prize. It's called the cloud chamber. And this is my favorite video. Show you. You can make one. Oh, I give you extra credit if you make one. A cloud chamber, you can make one.
What?
Yeah.
You can make that?
You can.
It's not dangerous.
No. You are above 21?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sure you can find tutorial online. So what they do, they have like some kind of aquarium upside down. Inside that aquarium, you have vapor, like it's alcohol vapor. And then you have cosmic rays coming from space, right? Zooming through the aquarium, and you can see the tracks, right? But by the way, every second you have all those particles going through your brain, you know, nonstop, going through your brain this way, going through the brain that way, nonstop. You don't see it, but it's going through you every second. So I think the way you do it, you have to put some alcohol here that will almost turn into liquid, but not quite so. So it's just vapor. And when a particle comes from space, kick the alcohol, alcohol will turn into liquid, and you see the trace. So you see, this is the alcohol here. Now, watch. Ooh, you see one here? Here. You see that? Ooh, a big one. Do you see this one? Look at that. Ooh, amazing. Do you see that? It's particles from space, coming from space and leaving a track behind. Here. There. Ooh. That was a really big one. And the music is fun, right? Here. So you can do that. It comes from YouTube. It's called Cosmic Ray Detector. It's something you can build at home. if you do it, you know, I'll give you extra credit. I don't think it's that hard to build, but of course, maybe it costs money, you know, to buy the aquarium and everything else. But at least you can detect cosmic ray coming from the universe, maybe from the sun. And what you have to understand is that every second we have the same thing going through our brain and through our body. But because we have such a wonderful immune system, we are designed to fix ourselves, right? So if the DNA is wrong, the proteins will fix the DNA. If the DNA cannot be fixed, so it will commit suicide. That's how we have evolved on Earth. Some scientists think that because of those cosmic rays, we had evolution, that it helped with evolution. I don't know. But that's very interesting. There was a Nobel Prize in the 1930s because now if you apply a magnetic field, some particles are going to spiral in one direction if it's positive. The negative one will spiral in another direction, and then you can identify the particles. And you see how they spiral around. They are losing kinetic energy because they are interacting with whatever is inside the cloud chamber. So you see, because they are losing speed, the curve, you know, the radius gets smaller because they are losing speed. Bigger speed, bigger radius. So I invite you to dig more into that if you want. So this is called the cloud chamber. You can build one if you want. So where does it go, this one? Up or down? Up, very good. Up, right? So it's going to go inside. It will be curved up. It will be deflected up. If it's negative, then you just do the opposite. It's going to be curved down. And it's very important for mass spectrometer. So again, this is the difference between an electric field and a magnetic field. Electric field works like gravity, right? So it's like this is up and that's down. So the charge wants to go to a lower level of energy, lower potential energy, right? It's like you have a mass here and this is up and this is down. It's like a projectile motion. So you throw something in the air, it wants to go down, and at the same time it's moving, so it's making a projectile motion. So along that direction, it's going to speed up. But at the same time, it's moving forward. So it's moving forward and speeding up along the electric field. So a positive charge always speed up along the electric field. The electric field tug on the charge. But if you have a magnetic field, the magnetic field cannot speed up the charge. The magnetic field can only curve it, right? So it's going to go in this direction. It tries to circulate around the magnetic field. Okay, so now we have all those equations here, but I think we already seen that. So the magnetic force is QVB, right? If V is perpendicular to B, the magnetic field is QVB, which is a centripetal force, which is equal to mv squared over r. So now you can isolate r, the radius, and you have the mass times velocity over the charge and the magnetic field. So you can predict the radius, you know, the curvature, given the mass. So big mass, big curve, because it has more inertia. More speed, bigger curve, because it wants to keep going, and then you have to curve it. And if the magnetic field, you increase it, you're going to have a smaller curve, and the charge, you increase it, you have a smaller curve. So that's going to give you that radius here. So I'm going to give you some examples, but here are all the equations that you need. That will be the radius when a charge is curved inside the magnetic field. You can find the period
So if you let the charge go around and around and around, you can find the time it takes to go around. So that will be the equation. So that equation is really cool because it does not depend on the speed. It just depends on the mass of the particle, the charge of the particle, and the magnetic field. Okay, so we're going to take an example. Slide 61. So what do you think here? Particle 1, is it positive or negative? Oh, and the magnetic field is towards you.
Magnetic field is this, in this direction, right? So V, magnetic field. So if it's positive, is it going to go down or up? Down, right? Magnetic field is dots. Dots is towards you, right? Let me do the same thing here. So V, magnetic field, force, down. So which one is positive? The particle 2 or the particle 1?
2.
Very good. That will be in the cloud chamber. And as the particle interact with alcohol, for example, or whatever is inside your cloud chamber, it's going to lose some speed, some kinetic energy. So the curve is getting tighter, right? The radius gets smaller.
And particle 1 will be a negative. Okay, let's do some computation.
Have you ever worked with any radioactive substances before?
The what?
Have you ever worked with anything radioactive?
Oh, I have a story. I used to work for a college, right? And at the time, they really didn't. They were not careful at all.
Oh.
So they used to have radioisotopes. They work on and then they will exchange between colleges. So one day we discover like a bunch of radioactive stuff in the department. And that was a big deal. No, now it's very, very regulated. You need to have a person who's certified, will have to deal with those radioisotopes. And we were around, I don't know. You know, those kind of thing is probability, you know? What's the probability you get messed up? I don't know. And how long is gonna take? I don't know. Okay, so what do we have? Let's go back. So QVB is your equation for the force. Remember that equals to the centripetal force. M V square over R. So we can isolate R, right? So M V square over Q V B. And you get the same equation, M V over Q B. The radius is in meter, the mass is in kilogram. The speed is in meter per second. That's going to be in Coulomb, and that's going to be in Tesla. Oh, and the magnetic field of the Earth is 0.5 times 10 to the negative 4 Tesla. It's very weak, but that's enough to protect us. So you have a fast electron, maybe coming from the sun, entering the magnetic field of our Earth, and it's going to be curved by the magnetic field. You know, maybe it's going to be the electron here. That's your speed. Maybe magnetic field is this way. So the radius depends on the mass of an electron. Do you have your equation sheet? I think it's 9.1 times 10 to negative 31. That will be the mass of an electron.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. The speed of an electron over the charge of an electron and the magnetic field of the Earth. So the electron comes zooming from space, and then it starts to circulate around the magnetic field lines of the Earth, so it doesn't reach us, so it's acting like a shield, which is good for us. So what do you get? Two times 10 to the 7, divide, open the parenthesis. It can go in two steps, so that way. I found that. Did you find that? 2.28 So if you have an electron zooming in, and these are the magnetic field lines of the Earth, the electron is going to curve around the magnetic field line and it's going to be trapped, you know, cannot escape. Now, as you increase the magnetic field, so if you increase the magnetic field, like the video I show you, the curvature will be smaller. So R will be smaller, right? So if you have a magnetic field times equals to 10 Tesla, the radius will be smaller. So it's still the same mass. It's the same speed. It's the same charge, but here the magnetic field is larger, so R is going to be bigger. Not bigger, smaller, right? Did you find that? What did you get? I have to do it? You get something smaller, right? Divide by the charge, 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19. Enter, and then you divide by 10. That thing here. Did you get that? Or I did a mistake? I don't know. I found the... I'll tell you what I found. Yeah. 1.13 times 10 to the negative 5. So it's very small. So a magnetic field of 10 Tesla is very strong. So you're going to curve it even more. Okay? That's just plugging in. There is nothing special here. Okay, so that's what is important for you. It's called the mass spectrometer. And the way it works, first, you're going to use an electric field to speed up your... Usually you work with isotopes, say, or molecules that ions that have lost an electron, for example, so they become positive. Or molecules you give an electron, so they are negative, right? So it has to be ions. So you have a bunch of ion here. You're going to accelerate those ions in an electric field because there will be a potential, electric potential. And then inside the magnetic field, it's going to be curved. So that way, you can collect whichever isotope you want to collect because the radius here depends on the mass. And you can even compute the mass of your isotope depending on the radius. Do you see the idea? And I have to show you the step here. Here, step, you speed them up inside an electric field. And then once it gets inside the magnetic field, it's going to be curved. And then you can collect them here depending on the radius. So let me first, I'm going to show you the math, but first I will show you how it was used in World War II. And it was designed by someone who got the Nobel Prize. His name was Ernest Lawrence from Caltech, and he was in charge of enriching uranium. So if you take uranium, 99.7% or something like 99% of uranium is uranium-238. And then you have less than 1%, which is uranium-235. You all understand isotopes, right? Which one has the larger mass, 238 or 235? 238. They both have 92 protons because it's uranium. But this one has three more neutrons than that one, so it's going to be heavier. So why do you want uranium-235? Because that's the only one that worked to make, for example, an atomic bomb. So during World War II, there was a race between Germany and the American to get the atomic bomb the first. So you need to have a critical mass to have enough uranium-235 to make an atomic bomb, right? Otherwise, it doesn't work. So they had to find a way to do what it's called enriching uranium. So you have to separate uranium-235 from uranium-238. So they will get a piece of uranium. Uranium is everywhere. We have a lot of uranium, especially in the US. Collect uranium, right? And then you turn that into a gas. And then you attach an electron to it, or you remove an electron so they become ions, you speed them up through a potential, high potential to low potential, so there is an electric field that speeds them up, and then all the isotopes get inside the magnetic field. The magnetic field will curve the isotopes, and you see that uranium-235 you can collect here because the radius is smaller. Okay, remember, radius depends on the mass. The heavier, even though they get a tug from the magnetic field to curve them up, the radius is bigger than here. And then you do that again and again and again and again until you have enough uranium-235. And there was a trick that they did, and that's how they had the first bomb, Hiroshima, August 6, 1946, I think. Was really bad, of course. Nothing was left except for a church. And then they did another bomb, the plutonium bomb. That was Nagasaki. But that's not physics, okay? I stick to physics. So the idea is that you can separate isotopes based on their mass. So that's the idea of a mass spectrometer. Not only you can separate isotopes, but you can also find the mass. Okay, you can find the mass of an isotope. So if there is something that you don't know and you want to find the mass, then you will use that method. Yeah. Oh no, once they had uranium-235, then it was solid again.
Oh, okay.
Right? And then it was called little boy, I think there was fat man and little boy. So the fat man was plutonium and the little boy was the uranium. So they take two pieces, basically take two pieces of uranium-235 and there is an explosion like TNT and they bring them together and you have a bomb, fission bomb. I forgot how it's done. But uranium bomb is very easy to make. What is hard to make is a plutonium bomb. Uranium, you need to enrich uranium. So that's the hard part. But once you have uranium, it's a very low tech, very easy to make. Plutonium is the opposite. Easy to get plutonium, it's very hard to make the bomb because it's an implosion bomb. I had a whole unit about the bombs, but I know students were not interested, so I gave up, so I kind of forget, but I can look back. I read a paper recently. I can send you the paper. It's an where they did a study with the spike proteins, you know, spike protein from the virus, and they wanted to know how cannabis affect the spike protein. Or everyone, what did you say? So no, but it was a true study. So they took spike protein, they attach little magnetic beads to the spike protein, and then they mix the spike protein with cannabis, you know, different molecules of cannabis. I don't know exactly what is in there, right? And they mix them together, and they wanted to know if cannabis stick to the spike protein. So maybe, you know, maybe, I don't know, having cannabis is protecting or something like this. I can send you the article. But the thing is that once they have everything mixed together, the spike proteins and the cannabis, they have that in a mass spectrometer so they can know which molecule stick to the spike proteins. Isn't that cool? I have to look up at that study. It's a peer review study, okay? I have to look it up. But my point is that a mass spectrometer has many applications. So I'm taking a tangent here. So anyway, here are the equations. So first, you're going to speed up your particle. So do you remember that voltage? So let's review for the test. The voltage is the energy per charge, right? So if you apply an electric field, it's going to speed up. The kinetic energy equals QV. QV, right? You can find the speed. So you can isolate the speed from here. Then you plug in it into that equation and you're going to have the mass as a function of the voltage and the B. So let's do the math so that will be easier. Let's isolate those equations here. Okay, what is... Okay, let's try to answer this one. Do you remember the equation? So you have F, you have QBR equals MV. From the previous equation. So you need to isolate the mass, right? You remember? QV, so that will be the speed, QVB equals MV square over R. We just did that, so you cross out this. So you have QBR equals MV, and that's going to be the speed. So you're just plugging in. So you have the radius, should put R. Magnetic field is zero, it's 8.0 Tesla. And the speed is 0.9 times the speed of light. Okay, so now you can do it, right? You just plug it in. I'm sure I can find that study. See, I'm not lying to you. And that's the study that they did, and they use a magnetic field. And it's a peer review paper. And they use a mass spectrometer to separate the molecules, right? If you want, I can send you the link. American Chemical Society, so it's not no, it doesn't mean that you think it means, okay, it doesn't mean that. But it's interesting. Okay, let's go back to here. Did you do it or no? Mass equals QBR over the speed. So what did you find? Oh, it doesn't say the charge?
Yeah.
What's the charge? This is the mass of a particle bearing a single... Oh, elementary charge means it's like a proton. Elementary charge is 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19. Times 8 times 0.35 divided by the speed. So 0.9 times 3 times 10 to the 8. So what do you get? So 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19 times 8 times 0.9. Okay, make sure I'm doing it right. 35. Did you get that? Oh, look at that. What is that?
What?
Yeah, it's not an electron, it's a proton, right? 1.67 times 10 to the negative 27. Isn't that cool? It means that you can use the mass spectrometer to find the mass of a particle, unknown particle, or or a molecule that you know it has a charge of plus one or minus one and you don't know the mass, then you can find the mass using that. That's exactly what they did for the study I was talking about. That's what they used here. It's so complicated, but it's so fascinating. Okay. Okay, so this one is interesting. Let's do it step by step. You have two electrons that are accelerated through a potential. So let's review for the test. Remember that potential is the energy per coulomb. So for one coulomb, potential energy is just the voltage. So the voltage is the potential energy per coulomb. So what you do, you have an electric field here. So let's say it's like a capacitor here, minus, and then you have plus, and you have an electron here. The electric field always goes from plus to minus, so the electron wants to go to the plus, so there will be a force equals to QE, right? So that force, QE, is going to turn, give it some kinetic energy. Here you have the voltage, and the kinetic energy of the electron is just QV, or E. V, right? So that's going to be the kinetic energy of an electron. From the last unit. So try to find their kinetic energy using that equation here. So remember, potential like 12 volt. If you have 12 volt, that means 12 joule per coulomb charge for one coulomb. So if you have a charge equals to E, your potential energy is just EV, the charge times the voltage. Okay, from last semester, not last semester. It sounds like last semester, last 2 weeks ago. So they want you to find the kinetic energy, okay? Because all that potential energy is going to turn into kinetic energy. It's like having a mass. You let go, it has potential energy. All that potential energy is going to turn into kinetic energy. So that's the same thing, right? So EV equals 0.5 mv squared. Yes or no? Right? It's like you have a mass, it has potential energy. You let go, it's going to turn into kinetic energy. Same way, here, the potential energy of the electron is going to be QV, so it's the potential times Q, and everything will be turned into kinetic energy, because the electric field will speed up. So what do you get? So kinetic energy equals the charge of an electron times the voltage, right? So 150. What do you get? Minus 17 watt and joules, right? Because it's energy, right? That's correct. 2.4 times 10 to the negative 17 joule. So you have those electrons here. you apply a voltage. It's like an electron gun. That's how it works. It's going to speed up. Here you have a hole. So they're going to come through that hole. They have a lot of speed. And then they enter a magnetic field. And then you can curve them up. So they are projected into a magnetic field. It's like the video I show you, okay? You have some kind of electron gun. The electron gun looks like this. So you have a battery here, a power supply. This is minus, this is plus. This is very hot. So all those little electrons are gonna be burped out and they're gonna go and speed up because they want to go to the other side where it's positive. But before that happens, you have a magnetic field and you're going to curve those electrons. But I don't know why I bother doing this because look, you have a nice picture here. So you have a filament that is very hot. You have electrons emitted by the filament. You apply a voltage, so the electrons are going to speed up. You know, all their potential energy, QV, is going to turn into kinetic energy. And then they enter a magnetic field, so they're going to be curved this way. No, like an electron gun is like this, you know, it's a cathode ray tube.
A cathode power source, yeah. Such as this one.
But if you buy one, you need a very high voltage, like 1,000 volt. But of course, yes, you can buy it because it's in the physics.
We need the Crookes tube, which has...
For physics lab.
A metal cathode, a metal anode, a screen that has been coated with a phosphorescent material that gives off light when struck by electrons, and a bar magnet. As we turn on the screen, we notice that...
Here you have your electron gun. You see, you are applying a very high voltage between the electrodes. So electrons here have a potential energy, QV, and all that potential energy is going to turn into kinetic energy. Nothing happens. But if you bring a magnetic field, it's going to bring a magnet.
We're able to see the cathode ray, this stream of electrons illuminating. We can use a magnet to show the deflection.
Here you go. Okay? So you apply a very high voltage. The electron are going to speed up, but then they enter a magnetic field, so they will be curved. By the way, when you are taking an X-ray, that's how it works, right? So you have electrons that have applied to a very high voltage, but here you put a target, like something heavy metal, so all those electrons are going to crush on your target, and all the kinetic energy is going to turn into X-ray. So that you cannot do at home, of course. That would be dangerous. Okay, so where are we? That's too many tangents. Let's go back to here. They are projected into a magnetic field where it goes into a circular path, find its momentum MV. So try to look back at slide 60 and try to find the right equation. So that's going to be the kinetic energy, right? Number two, remember that we have QBR equals mass times the speed, that's called the momentum. And what do they want? See, I forget. Find the momentum MV. Oh, that's easy. Do you remember from physics one, momentum is M times V, right?
Yeah.
Remember that? MV is the momentum, mass times speed. And you have QBR equals MV from the things that we just did. So find the momentum. I don't know if you remember from physics one, but momentum is, the notation is P. So that's called momentum. So I give you time to do it, okay? So you have B, you have the radius, you have the charge, and you need to find the radius. The momentum, sorry. So what is B? So 25 times 10 to the negative 3 Tesla. And the radius is 7.1 centimeters. So it's 7.1 times 10 to the negative 2 meters. Did you get that? It's 25 millitesla. So 25 times 10 to the negative 3. 7.1 centimeters. So it's 7.1 times 10 to the negative 2. Yes? So what do you get? B. R. Anyone? Marie, what did you get? Who are my computers here? Anthony, what do you get? Times 10 to the 22? So kilogram meter per second. That's momentum. Mass times V. Yes? Plug in it. Okay, next question. So again, you speed up the electrons through a voltage. The electrons are going to have kinetic energy because they are tugged by an electric field. And that kinetic energy, you know, they get inside the magnetic field, so they're going to be curved, right? The magnetic field cannot change the speed, but they can make them curve. Okay, find the speed. How can we find the speed? So we know that the kinetic energy, 0.5 mv square, equals 2.4 times 10 to the negative 17 joules, right? And we know that this is mv. So that will be your kinetic energy. So 0.5 times mv times v equals 2.4 times 10 to the negative 17 joules. Can we find v now? If we write the kinetic energy this way, mv squared is mv times v. Do we have mv? Huh? What? Momentum, very good. We have MV. MV is the momentum. So all you have to do is to plug the momentum here and you can isolate the speed. So this is very boring math. So momentum is 2.8 times 10 to the negative 22
That's a 22 times the speed equals 2.4 times 10 to the negative 17. And I'm trying to isolate V. Did I do a mistake? 0.5 times the momentum times the speed equals kinetic energy. What did you get? All right, 2.4 10 divided by, no, it should not be a big, big, so. So you get what you get? 1.71 times 10 to the 5? Oh yeah, that's cool. Because that's usually the order of magnitude for a speed for electrons. It has to be smaller than the speed of light, which is 10 to the 8, but 10 to the 5th, that will be the order of magnitude. Okay? So that's how a spectrometer works. You speed the ions, it doesn't have to be an electron, you speed them up through a voltage. And then they go into a magnetic field, so they will be curved, and then you can collect them. Oh, see, find its mass. Okay, let's find the mass. So go back to the equation and find the mass. You have different way to do it. If you go back to the kinetic energy here, you see kinetic energy is 1/2 mv squared. So you have the speed. You have the speed. You square it, and you can isolate the mass, right? Are we talking about a proton, or did they say it was a proton, or it's electrons, right? So we should find the mass of an electron if we did it correctly. So kinetic energy is 1/2 mv squared, and the kinetic energy is 2.4 times 10 to the negative 17 joule. And the speed we have, right? So 1/2. Mass is unknown. Speed is 1.71 times 10 to the 5th. You can use the momentum. Oh, yeah, the momentum will be easier, right? You find the mass of the proton?
Yeah.
So I guess it's a proton, it's not an electron? So there's a mistake somewhere. So let me check. So that's kinetic energy. So 2.4 times 10 to the negative 17. 1.6, right?
But then wouldn't the charge be different?
No, the charge of a proton and the charge of an electron, they are the same. So I guess there was a mistake somewhere because it's supposed to be an electron. So 2.4 times 10 to the negative 17, enter, times 2, enter, divide by 1.71 times 10 to the 5. Yeah, it's a proton. So there was a mistake. In the text, it should be a proton. That's square. So 2.4 times 10 to the negative 17 times 2. Yeah, yeah, you're right. If I use the kinetic energy, I find also mass equals 1.67 times 10 to the negative 27 kilograms. Okay, so I guess it's not an electron, it's a proton. Okay, any question? It's a lot of... find its mass. But that's how it works. So the idea is always you have a bunch of isotopes, for example. You want to split them apart or you want to find the mass. So you're going to speed them up through an electric field by applying a voltage. So you're going to have QV will be the kinetic energy. And then they enter a magnetic field. They will be curved, right, depending on their mass. So then you have some detectors here, and you can separate them, and you can identify them. That's what they did. Like, especially if you are in the medical field, I encourage you to read that article because they show you, you know, how to use a mass spectrometer. It's not like I pretend that I understand something, okay? I don't. I just understand the physics behind it because it's a very complicated here. Okay, I wanted to cover something else, but okay. Let's see. Okay, so I don't know if you know, but between France and Switzerland, we have something called the Large Hadron Collider. Okay, the Large Hadron Collider, it's an atom smasher. You know that, right? Atom smasher. So what they do, they take protons. So they use hydrogen. Once they have hydrogen, they extract the protons from the hydrogen and they're going to speed up these protons, you know, and then speed up and then speed up and then speed up. And then at the end, they're going to crush them together. And because they destroy them, and E equals MC squared according to Einstein, so you destroy something, you have pure energy, and out of the pure energy, you have new stuff, crystallized, like new particles. And that's how they found the Higgs boson. Higgs boson is like the particle of God. That's what they call it. Yeah, the God particle. The Higgs boson, it's called. Yeah. It's because the Higgs boson, it's what explains why things have mass. How can you explain that? Higgs boson, it was a Nobel Prize in 2013 or something like this. So anyway, I want to show you how it works.
Insignificant though, this bottle of...
Because it's exactly what we are doing.
Compressed hydrogen gas looks. It marks the beginning of the world's largest and most powerful particle accelerator chain, culminating in CERN's spectacular Large Hadron Collider.
So it's between Switzerland and France, and it's inside, it's underground. So you have a tunnel like this.
Hydrogen atoms from this gas cylinder collider.
But now I lost my sound.
hydrogen atoms from this gas cylinder are fed at a precisely controlled rate into the source chamber of a linear accelerator, CERN's LINAC 2, where their electrons are stripped off to leave hydrogen.
So here you have, when you remove the electrons from the hydrogen, what is left? Protons, very good, right? And then you're gonna apply a high voltage, QV, so they're gonna speed up, okay? Because they're gonna be tugged by an electric field.
These are protons and have a positive charge, enabling them to be accelerated by an electric field. Their journey to eventually take part in ultra-high energy collisions, similar to those following the Big Bang, can now begin. This initial acceleration has caused LINAC 2 to be likened to the lumbering first stage of a huge rocket. By the time this packet of protons leaves LINAC 2, it'll be traveling at one-third the speed of light. It's about to enter the booster, stage 2 of the rocket, if you will. In order to maximize the intensity of the beam, the packet is divided up into four, one for each of the booster's rings. Straight acceleration.
So how do you think you make them going around? Magnetic field, right? So the magnetic field cannot speed them up, but they will contain them, right? And each round, they're going to speed up with an electric field. Go around, speed up with an electric field. Go around, speed up with an electric field. And then they go to huge speed, or almost the speed of light.
Is now impractical, and the booster is circular, 157 meters in circumference. In order to accelerate the packets, they are repeatedly circulated, and the electric field is now pulsed, in the same way that you push a child on a swing each time they reach a certain point. Magnets exert a force on the passing protons at right angles to their direction of motion, and so powerful electromagnets are used to bend the beam of protons.
Isn't that cool? So of course they are not going to use a horseshoe magnet, they're going to use an electromagnet, and they have to cool it down to very low temperature, so it costs a lot of money. It's like a very, very low temperature electromagnet to be as efficient as possible. So you have two things here. The electric field is pushing them, making them go faster, and the magnetic field is trapping them. You go around and faster and around and faster and around.
Round the circle. The booster accelerates the protons up to 91.6% of the speed of light and squeezes them closer together. Recombining the packet from the four rings, it's then flung on into the proton synchrotron, by analogy, stage 3 of our rocket. Let's just follow two such proton packets. The proton synchrotron is 628 meters in circumference, and they circulate for 1.2 seconds, reaching over 99.9% of the velocity of light. It's here that the point of transition is reached, a point where the energy added to the protons by the pulsating electric field cannot translate into increased velocity, as they're already approaching the limiting speed of light. Instead, the added energy manifests itself as increasing mass of the protons. In short, the protons can't go faster, so they get heavier. The microscopic kinetic energy of each proton is measured in units called electron volts, and now the energy of each proton has risen to 25 giga electron volts, or GeV. The protons are now 25 times heavier than they are at rest. The packets of protons are now channeled into stage 4, the superproton synchrotron, a huge ring 7 kilometers in circumference, designed specifically to accept protons at this energy and increase it to 450 GeV. Soon, the packets of protons will be energized sufficiently to be launched into the orbit of the gigantic Large Hadron Collider, or LHC, which lies between the Jura Mountains and the Alps, and straddles both France and Switzerland. Lying deep underground, it has a circumference of 27 kilometers. There are two vacuum pipes within the LHC, containing proton beams traveling in opposite directions. Using ultra-sophisticated kickers to synchronize incoming packets with those already circulating, one vacuum pipe has injected into it protons which will circulate clockwise, and the other protons which will circulate anti-clockwise. The counter-rotating beams cross over in the four detector caverns, where they can be made to collide. The energy of the collision is double that of the individual opposing protons, and it's the debris from these collisions that is trapped in the detectors. For half an hour, the SPS injects protons. Finally, there are 2,808 packets. During this time, the LHC adds extra energy to each proton, whose velocity is now so near the speed of light that it goes round the 27-kilometer ring over 11,000 times each second, getting a boost of energy at each revolution from the pulsed electric field. Finally, each proton has an energy of 7 tera electron volts, and they're 7,000 times heavier than at rest. The magnetic force needed to keep the beams bending to the ring is so enormous that nearly 12,000 amps must flow through its electric magnets. This is achieved by making the LHC colder than outer space, so that its magnets become superconducting.
Imagine the money it costs.
Now the protons are ready to collide in detectors.
Billions of euros. It's like several countries coming together
to a collision course. The total energy of two protons colliding in the LHC is 14 tera electron volts and reproduces similar states to moments after the Big Bang. Particle tracks of these collisions will be analyzed by computers connected to the detectors, and it's hoped these tracks will give a new insight into the very birth of our universe. How our universe has evolved, what governs its behavior today, and where it's going in the future.
So they did find it, okay? So you can do research. It's called the Higgs boson. Higgs boson, that was a Nobel Prize. And they discovered it.